36th NCAA Women's Volleyball Champion will be decided tonight in Columbus, Ohio. And we have a matchup that has surprised most experts. The kids from Stanford, along with three-time All-American Inki Ejonikhu, upset Minnesota Thursday night to advance to a record 15th final. Well, the Texas Longhorns avenged a championship defeat last year by sweeping and stunning rival Nebraska. These two teams have overcome much and given everything to earn a shot at the title.
Think about where it all started. Where did the dream begin for you? When you knew there wasn't any other place you'd rather be, you put in the time. You showed up again and again. Through the struggle and adversity, you discovered beauty in the game. You never settled for less. This will be the hardest hurdle. I challenge you to rise in this moment. Continue to chase the winning spirit that burns inside of you. So when you look back on this time in your life, you can say, I gave everything.
Watching the NCAA Women's Volleyball Championship presented by Northwestern Mutual as we welcome you back inside Nationwide Arena, where on Thursday night the Cardinal advanced by beating Minnesota 3-1 behind 18 stuffed blocks. Well, Texas was unstoppable once again offensively as they swept the number one seeded and defending champion Nebraska Cornhuskers. So our matchup is set. Texas taking on Stanford. Hi, everybody, and welcome. I'm Paul Sunderland, joined once again by the U.S. Olympic team head coach and my old teammate, Karch Kirai. We'll hear from Holly Rowe in just a moment. These two elite programs, Karch, and they are certainly that by definition, the 21st time combined that these two teams have played for this championship. But at least of late, it's been a little bit hard getting it across the finish line, as it should be.
In fact, Texas has been in the eight of the last nine semifinals, but only come away with one title. Stanford hasn't won since 2004, so both teams you could think of as dry and very hungry for a championship.
For the Stanford Cardinal, it's their 34th match of the year, so their star-studded lineup of freshmen is no longer playing like it, but there is no question who leads this team.
Inki and the Inkettes, it is Inki's huddle. As her coach, John Dunning, says, the other night he even waited for her to finish in the huddle, and she is leading this team in every way, certainly offensively and blocking at the net, but inspiring her teammates. A critical intermission last week when down 2-0 at Wisconsin, and they perform in every phase of the game defensively, and even Jenna Gray running the offense for them.
The Texas Longhorns come in as the number four seed, but they have been red hot offensively, just like they were in 2012 when they won the title. Why have they been so hard to slow down?
I think the number one reason is the resurgence of Ebony Wanabu. She was so good as a freshman at USC 3 years ago. Had some injuries, really took a lot of time to work back, and look at that number, so hot, 444 in the NCAA tournament. Those are middle numbers, not opposite numbers, where she's facing a much stronger block.
The 36th NCAA Women's Volleyball Champion will be crowned shortly here before 17,000 at Nationwide Arena in Columbus, Ohio. Number one. Shank pass, that still do it. Stanford's moving on. Johnson for the win, and Texas is moving on.
Save thousands at Sequins RV year and clearance sale with insane dealer price cuts and huge.
She takes over the huddles. Her leadership is lifting her team. In fact, they were down 2-9 against Wisconsin. And in the locker room, she told her team to breathe and focus on the next play and realize how good they are. Her teammates say, we are confident in ourselves and we win because Inki believes that we do. look they have gives me chills. I know they're about to go and tear it up. We'll see if that's the case tonight against Texas. And now let's learn more about Stanford and Texas.
I'm Kelsey Humphreys. I'm a senior DS setter at Stanford University, and I want to introduce my team. Catherine Plummer at outside hitter, aka Plum Dog Millionaire. Moretta Lutz at opposite, 6 foot, 7 foot, 8 foot mutts. Ivana Vanyak at outside hitter. Adriana Fitzmorris at middle blocker, aka Fitz. Holland McKenna at DS. Morgan Hentz at libero, but we like to call her Cotton-Eyed Mo. Inky Ajanaku at middle blocker. Jenna Gray at setter, also known as J-Money.
My name is Chloe Collins. I'm the setter for the University of Texas, and here's my ride or dies. At outside, we have number one, Makaya White, aka Kaya. Then our opposite, we have Ebony Wanabu. We have Nicole Dalton, aka Cole. Our libero is Kat McCoy. At middle blocker, we have Slow Mo Johnson, Autumn Roundsville, our DS. At outside, we have number 19, Bao Balina Prieto Cerame. Number 27 is Yasmin Verdot Hani, aka Yazzy.
Eighth all-time meeting between Texas and Stanford in the NCAA tournament, and the first ever for the championship. Texas, as the higher seed, will be the home team wearing their white uniforms, and it'll be number one in black, Jenna Gray, the freshman setter, to start things off, and we're underway. Tough set on the outside. Nicole Dalton taking a risk there, and that ball hit out of bounds by Prieto Cerame. Jared Elliott in his 16th year as head coach at the University of Texas, as we mentioned just moments ago, a champion in 2012. This is his fourth appearance in a championship match. And that ball served just out of bounds. At the other end for the Stanford Cardinal in his 16th year and in his ninth championship match, John Dunning, two titles at Stanford, two previously at the University of Pacific, and for the second time this year, just a couple of days ago, named the National Coach of the Year for 2016 and previously in 2001. Tight set over the top of the block. Morgan Hentz, whose name we're going to be calling an awful lot in the libero's jersey. And a very nice swing for Stanford's 6'8" redshirt junior, Moretta Lutz, out of Houston, Texas. You've already seen something early that Texas is doing in terms of their blocking against Ajanaku.
Absolutely. They got three blockers in front of Ajanaku. They want to have at least four hands, if not six. A lot of focus on Ajanaku when she's attacking, and Inky, on the other hand, jumping as hard as she can to get the good touches out on the left side.
Ebony Wanabu, another very, very smart shot off the top of the block. Now let's take a look at planning for success presented by Northwestern Mutual.
And really the key is, can these four freshmen continue? Can they continue to believe Inky when she says, you are good enough to get this done? She was inspiring to them last weekend, especially down 0-2 against Wisconsin. For Texas, got to knock their block off. This is a really strong block, the best in the country, that gave Minnesota fits, 18 stuffs in four sets.
Expected a lot of long rallies, and we're getting exactly that. In system, out of system, good dig there, right to the net, and Ebony Wanabu with her second kill down the line. Averaging 3.7 kills per set on the year, hitting 384. I'll explain that a little more later. In terms of hitting efficiency, you take the number of kills minus the number of errors, divided by the number of attempts. It's not a straight batting average, it's an efficiency. She was number one in the Big 12 Conference, and hitting 384 is supposed to be reserved for middle blockers, not for somebody who plays on one of the pins.
Absolutely, and so far you can see Stanford trying to exert a lot of pressure at the service line. They've already missed two serves. The game is very early, and they're trying to create better blocking situations with a tough serve.
Here is Kat McCoy, the libero for Texas. Good set to Wop. Wanabu tipping over the top. Hentz was there. A little bit of a traffic jam on the left side. And stuff straight down. Wanabu at 6'4" with Morgan Johnson, the 6'3" sophomore, number 12 in white out of DeSoto, Texas.
And this is what we call a trap set. You don't want to put the ball, A, you don't want to put the ball that close, and B, Vanyak has to take a smarter swing than that. Too low, right into the blocker's forearms.
Going away from Vanyak. Lutz is dug. Another point scoring opportunity off the edge of the block. Lutz is stuffed. Mikhail White, number one in white, the 6'1" redshirt freshman who missed all of last year with a foot injury, and an outstanding blocker, Karch, for such a young player.
And one of the things she does is dive in into the cross-court shot very late after the hitter's already committed to hitting it.
Quick 5-1 run for Texas, and Adriana Fitzmorris gets the Cardinal out of that troublesome rotation. Fitzmorris, 6'6", freshman out of Overland Park, Kansas. Yep, this is the tallest team at Stanford among the women athletes, much taller than the basketball team for Tara Vanderveer.
Probably taller than some men's college basketball teams out there.
Look at that angle by Ebony Wanabu, slicing and dicing inside about the 5-foot line. And so far, as Texas did last night against Nebraska, they are passing the ball much better than their season resume would indicate.
Yeah, and in fact, Coach Elliott, after the semifinals, talked about, you know what, our passers have been questioned for 10 years. I am so proud of how they handled the serving of Nebraska, and that was his biggest concern going into that semifinal.
Jenna Gray, number one there, with the second contact kill. And Catherine Plummer, the National Freshman of the Year, keep an eye on her, number two in black for Stanford, there in the left front, to the left of your screen, serving her an awful lot, but she's been handling it. Perfect pass again on the slide. Boy, what a start offensively once again for Texas.
Yeah, Catherine Plummer reaching the wrong way. That shot by Johnson, a very good swing, but not that difficult to block if you take the cross court away.
Here is Mikaia White. Sometimes her serving, most of the season, has been an adventure, but she's found something late. Plummer over the top of the block and out of bounds. No touch detected. Best 3 out of 5 sets. First 4 sets to 25 points. Must win by 2. Fifth set, if necessary, will be played to 15. We also have the video review system available. 3 challenges per team and a quick timeout called by Stanford. And once again, it's Ebony Wanabu starting things out for the unstoppable offense of Texas.
I think this one will interest you.
It's a good day. Feels really good to be alive.
For Ebony Wanabu, with 3 kills so far, it is a dream come true to be playing in this national championship game. As a young lady, 9 years old, she wrote a letter to herself talking about how she wanted to play volleyball. I want to be a scholarship for volleyball. It gives me confidence to speak up, and volleyball makes me stronger. Someday, I want to be a professional volleyball star. And until that day, here she is playing in the national championship. Things come true when you imagine them when you're 9 years old. What a wonderful story for Ebony Wanabu.
Started her career at USC, where she was National Freshman of the Year, missed all of last season save for one match. That was a win for Texas over Nebraska. Talk about serving being a little bit of an adventure. There is a part of that. One good, one bad.
And just Mikaia White, a bit outside.
Mikaia White had a great line. Her teammates call her the Shaquille O'Neal of serving. 50%. I only make them when I need to.
Exactly. And you know what? You'll take it on the serving that much better than on the hitting. That's the one I expected Inki Ajanaku to take. Paulina Prieto-Sorame loves to hit the sharp cross court, and Inki Ajanaku was all over this. Watch her reach to her left and get those hands way across the net. That's Prieto-Sorame's favorite shot. And this is a rotation where Inki can really focus. Oh, Inki, big mistake, leaning the other way there.
Holland McKenna with a nice dig in the backcourt, and that ball tipped to the floor. And coming out of the timeout, Stanford quickly goes on a little mini run and are back within contact with Texas here at 9-8. Yeah, I thought so. My math, I didn't get into Stanford, so wait a minute, was that 2 or 3?
Neither of us did.
Well, you could have. I had no shot. 3-0 run for Fitzmorris along with the Stanford Cardinal.
Look for a John Acuda. Lean to her right toward Prieto Sarame. Or a good touch there. That's another way to solve the problem of a bad matchup. Prieto Sarame on Inki Ajanaku. Collins with a good decision to attack on the second contact using all of her 5'7" frame.
Yeah, very surprising. You might be more likely to see it from Jenna Gray at 6'1", the setter for Stanford, but at 5'7", not something that, right on cue. Thank you very much, Jenna. Right back at you, what you can do, Chloe. Jenna Gray, I can do equally well. And what do you think of the body language, Karch, of both of these teams so far in this big moment as far as just their subtle things, the ball contact and whatnot?
They look like they're excited to play. What you have to be careful of is just, are you going to be too excited? You've got to be playing in a proper activation level. Here's another chance for Inki to block cross court.
And that ball missed out of bounds.
And what I would say is that stuff block by Inki earns the other point. She's already inside Prieto Sarame's head a little. Sarame there trying to evade the block and hitting the ball 5 feet out of bounds.
Texas has two hitting errors, and Prieto Sarame has both of them, make it three, and she has all three of them. Texas continues to pass the ball very well. On the pipe, back row, quick combination for Micaiah White. Let's go back over to the sideline and Holly Rowe.
Well, you know, you're talking about Prieto Sarame and getting in her head with that big block of Ajanaku. That was one of the concerns for Jarrett Elliott. He said, I worry that if we get blocked and keep getting roofed, that it will get in our head a little bit. We'll see if she can come out of this continuing with a better attitude.
And you also have to give Prieto Sarame a ton of credit. Coach was telling her, this team is going to go, as they were getting on the plane to come here, we're going to go as far as you go emotionally. And she was a huge leader against Nebraska.
There is Plummer. Really good point by Holly Rowe. Yasmin Bedart-Ani, wearing number 27 in white, the 6'4 sophomore out of Los Angeles. And what a story. She really helped. You know, it's not a turnaround for Texas when you're 27-4. But she took them, after having played outside last year in the opposite in the national semifinals, and made the all-tournament team at Janaku with that kill. And to finish the thought on Bedart-Ani, she wasn't playing a lot the beginning of the year. She didn't play in 9 of the first 14 matches, and Jarrett Elliott said, we need some help in the middle. And Bedart-Ani had not played as a middle blocker since the 8th or 9th grade, and she's been superb.
Two of the things. Number one, you've got to give her credit, huge credit. She still hasn't gotten to play the position she was recruited to play.
Last year,
plugging in at opposite. This year, playing another new position she's never played and doing a fantastic job. And then number two, Coach Elliott just saying, hey, we put it together with duct tape. We've done all kinds of things. But struggling through that, he thinks, has made them a better team.
Remember the timeout called by Stanford at 9-6. Since that time, they have gone on a 9-3 run to take the lead 14-12.
What is it you want, Barry?
How much parity there is, and Stanford looking to tie Penn State for the all-time lead with NCAA championships. Good dig right in system on top of the net. Bedart-Ani. Oh, Morgan Haddon's. And Chloe Collins is there, and a net violation is going to be called against the Stanford Cardinal. And John Dunning up off the sideline asking Moretta Lutz if she netted.
Wow, Morgan Hentz, look at the hustle on this play. They don't win the rally, but she has been playing phenomenal defense, not only all season, but getting better as the tournament's going on.
And dare I say, an early Luigi breaking out the left and needing to. Here's Micaiah White tucking down inside. Micaiah White, first team all Big 12, first team all American, and the freshman of the year. And like Ebony Wanabu, missed all of last season with a foot injury. Tied at 14. McCoy serving once again for Texas. Through the hands of Plummer, she's been trying to take a lot of serves overhand. Wanabu off the edge that time of Ivana Vanyak. So continuing very smart shot selection for Ebony Wanabu.
Now 5 kills in 10 swings. She's even beating her tournament average at a cool 500, almost at that through the tournament. And expect Texas to keep feeding her. She has good blockers in front of her, still finding success.
Very easy serve, ripped into the cross court, and another net violation nullifies a brilliant dig that time by Chloe Collins.
You talked about easy serving, Paul. One of the things we're tracking is what we call in-system or good pass percentage. Texas at a very high level, almost 70%. Stanford even higher at 83. So both teams, that one would not be an in-system pass. That was not as good a pass, but look who saves it. And it's so nice to have Wanabu on your side of the net to save those out-of-system plays.
Taking out the trash. That's what the opposite does an awful lot. And what advantage, being in system, does the offense give over the defense?
Well, when you're in system, it means you can set any one of your options, and that keeps the opposing middle blocker occupied. She's going to arrive to the different spots of attack much later. Nice up by Hintz.
Vanyak with a rip down the line, looking for a touch, and none detected. That ball hit out of bounds. Mentioned the video replay system. You get 3 per match per team. Ball in and out, touch off the block, service line foot fault. Here is Wanabu again.
And to me, it looks like Stanford's trying too hard to hit over Chloe Collins, so they're hitting right out of bounds. Plummer made the mistake, and then Vanyak later.
Deep set out of the backcourt, deflected. Nice touch by Wanabu.
That's not going to go on Hintz.
Bang, bang play. John Dunning wanted 4 contacts.
Brownsville really doing a nice job serving and hitting. Wow.
Slicing and dicing is Mikaia White into the cross court. Morgan Hintz was in a pretty good spot, but not good enough to get that shot.
Going sharp inside that red area, inside the 3-meter zone.
Remember, we were watching the teams warm up, and Eric Sullivan, assistant coach at the University of Texas and former Olympian, almost had his head taken off by Mikaia White. There's Eric Sullivan, an outstanding libero, All-American at UCLA. And he almost took a real shot. Mikaia White, who's been tipping a lot and who's been playing very conservatively throughout the course of this tournament, has come out right now and taken some big swings. Texas led early 9-4, forced an early timeout. Then Stanford came back with a huge run. And now Texas once again, boy, this is stop and start. Both teams going on big runs against one another.
And that can easily happen. A good team can get on a roll very quickly. But the good team on the other side of the net, especially after a timeout and resetting a little, can turn it right back around. I would imagine some pretty big swings of momentum here.
The story and the headline and the biggest concern when I spoke with John Dunning earlier today at their practice was number 2, Ebony Wanabu. Saw her at USC and didn't think he'd have to deal with her again. But when you play Texas in the finals, there is Ebony Wanabu.
Including that really sharp cut shot. She's got some nice, what we would call wrist control, and able to place the ball to different spots on the court.
Let's go down to Holly.
Well, you know, Ebony Wanabu is an intriguing story. She started her career, as you mentioned, at USC, a National Freshman of the Year, but was plagued by performance anxiety. She said, there were times I would be on the court and I would feel paralyzed by fear. She struggled to get out of her own head and find a way to be good. But she has been working with sports psychologists at Texas. She's feeling in a much better space. And I would dare say that her performance, happiness, and exuberance is what's driving this Texas team right now. A good way to get out of her own mind.
And to add to that, Holly, it's been really admirable that Ebony has shared that. She's a really good writer and written about that and felt like she was alone, but gotten responses from all over the country saying, you know, I have that same thing. Where it might show up most, Paul, is at the service line, but she had a really good serving game the other night, and she just hit a great one there.
Challenging Hintz once again into the cross court and right back. the National Freshman of the Year out of Aliso Viejo, California, Catherine Plummer. We talked about the length. Plummer is 6'6". Moretta Lutz is 6'8". And Adriana Fitzmorris is 6'6" as well. What a smart shot by Micaiah White, getting to that ball and finding a small seam through the Stanford block.
You know, if I were Stanford on a play like that, I would think of maybe pushing over and get Plummer involved in the block too, blocking with three, getting a bigger block on Micaiah White.
Stanford's block has not really impacted Texas so far. Here is White. And now 1 for 3. Made her first and got Stanford out of system, and she's missed the last two, one long and one into the net. And here is Fitzmorris out of Overland Park, Kansas. Her mother, Maria, from Peru, was both on their national basketball team and volleyball team, as versatile as her daughter. Nice dig in the cross court by the aforementioned Fitzmorris. And Ajanaku didn't get great wood on it, but somehow got that into the cross court corner. Poor choice that time by Chloe Collins.
Poor choice by Collins, and a poor choice by Johnson as a blocker to not focus on Ajanaku. You got to get two blockers up against her.
Another run. This opening set has just been full of them. Stanford on a 4-1 run. Bang, bang, play, and bang, bang, right back at you. Jenna Gray with a roof.
Wow, Inky Ajanaku, watch how she hangs and just rejects that first one. Then the second one, one-on-one, and really cooling Prieto Sarame off. She was unstoppable, almost a career postseason match against Nebraska the other night.
Jenna Gray, number one in black for Stanford. Remember the blocking match she had against Minnesota, the fastest offense in the country. Not only did she chip in with 5 kills, a big number for a setter, 12 digs, but also got her hands in on 6 blocks as well. On Wednesday, the Bluegrass State rivalry between Kentucky and Louisville kicks off at 7 Eastern on ESPN. It's Calipari versus Patino for a Holiday Hoops matchup presented by Zales, and it's a sonic blockbuster. Kentucky Wildcats ranked number 6, Louisville at number 11. Once again, that's Wednesday at 7 on ESPN. With Holly Rowe on the sideline, our U.S. Olympic team head coach, Karch Kirai, I'm Paul Sunderland. Thanks so much for joining us. Let's take a look at Stanford. They, like Penn State, are the only two teams to participate in every NCAA volleyball tournament. They hold the record for most wins at 114. Their 15th national championship appearance. They have 6 titles in all, the second most, trying to tie Penn State. Penn State did such a wonderful job at one point, winning 4 in a row and then also in 13 and 14. And you got to remember, for Texas and for Stanford, Texas somehow survived at home against BYU in the regional semifinals, down in the 5th set 11-5, and Stanford was down 2-0 at number 3 overall seed Wisconsin and came back to win. Prieto Sarame, boy, did she ever need that. Much needing a kill to rebuild her confidence after some early struggles. Once again, let's go back down to Holly Rowe.
Well, in that last timeout for Texas, Jarrett Elliott reminded his team, look, this isn't going to be easy. This is the national championship game. But if we stick together, I want to see good, positive body language. We're going to be fine, but it's going to be hard.
Wow, that serve was really close. Remember, 3 challenges available. Of course, one of those is ball in and out. Coach Elliott talking to his floor captain as to whether or not he should challenge. Jenna Gray also getting a word to the wise. Well, the coaches will tell the respective players exactly where they want to serve. Of course, that's a big part of the game plan. Nicely handled by Prieto Sarame. Oh, and another roof. Hitting against 6'8", Moretta Lutz, and the highest flyer out of the middle, number 12, Ajanaku.
Watch Inky Ajanaku in the middle there. She is jumping as hard as she can. She's getting her armpits over the net. That is the toughest block you can set into. Moretta Lutz at 6'8", and then Inky Ajanaku.
22-20 advantage out of the back row again. Hints all over that. Good first contact. Tanaku straight down. What a pass by Morgan Hints.
Absolutely. She reads this so well. You are not going to fool her on any tip play. So she makes the perfect pass so that Ajanaku can even run and attack in transition. Now 23-20 Stanford.
8-2 run for the Cardinal coming out of the timeout. Prieto Sarame.
Oh,
Morgan Hence sprawling again, giving Stanford a chance. And on the slide, really good choice that time and a read offensively. Bedard on knee, going for that gap set and putting that ball away.
I like what Collins, Chloe Collins, is doing for Texas, mixing it up. She's not just setting left side the whole time and getting some other hitters one-on-one looks.
Strongest rotation for Texas with a 5-7 Collins in the back line. And Ajanaku able to go off speed against three blockers. There's got to be some open space. Set points now for the Stanford Cardinal. What a streaky opening set. Good use of timeouts by both coaches and paying dividends. And another stuff on the outside. Stanford's block was quiet early when Texas had the lead, 18-15. But after that, between Moretta Lutz, Inki Ajanaku, among others, Stanford closes with four stuff blocks and takes the opening set 25-21 behind three-time All-American Inki Ajanaku.
Entering the gates of
and playing in the program that is just so fantastic with the athletes and the coaches and the athletic department. It's just a magical place, and it was the foundation for everything for me.
You've been in so many big championship moments. What would you tell these young women right now about competing right now, how to get through a championship moment?
Oh man, don't stop. At the end of game one, the Cardinal, they got into their rhythm. You know, this is a game of rhythm and momentum. Big stuff block, and they took a deep breath and they just kept going. So keep doing you, Cardinal.
Thank you, Carrie.
You're welcome. Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
Thank you, Holly. Thank you, Carrie. Carrie, also most outstanding player of the national championship as a freshman. As we get ready to open the second set, and Texas will have to make some adjustments. Chloe Collins again will start in the strongest rotation. And that ball missed out of bounds. Plummer into the cross court. So Chloe Collins starts in the backcourt. Strongest rotation for Texas, but Catherine Plummer is able to get Stanford right out of it.
And now Stanford has a nice matchup. The matchup they would like on Ebony Wanabu. They have Lutz and Ajanaku blocking out there. Looking at those first set statistics, Prieto Sarame with 6 hitting errors. Texas with 5 serving errors, Morgan Hintz with 10 digs. That's a big part of the difference.
Well, if you're coaching Paulina Prieto Sarame, one of the emotional leaders of this Texas team, what do you do? Because she was 1 of 15 with 6 errors. She had all 6 of Texas's hitting errors, and she has got to pull herself out of this if Texas is going to come back.
Yep, she's got to hit smarter. And that means not hitting low and hard. This block is too tall, so she has to aim for the fingers and not the elbows, or hit the outside hand and not the middle blocker's armpits.
Texas had been hitting 356 in the NCAA tournament coming in. Stanford's block and defense of Morgan Hintz held the Longhorns to 182 in the opening set.
We're not the Stanford math majors, but I'm going to call that about half. and that's what they've been doing. They did that to a very potent offense for Minnesota just 2 days ago.
Lots of time just underway. Remember, best 3 out of 5 sets, first 4 sets to 25 points. Thank you, Ajanaku. Wristing right over the top of the block. Beautiful delivery by Jenna Gray.
And you can see Texas is focusing so much on her. They're putting 2 blockers up, but she just neutralizes that. Not only does she hit over him, she hits over him to the middle of the court, to the 15-foot line.
There's no defense designed for that. Did you expect a much more steady diet of Ebony Wanabu, given the other problems that they've been having with Prieto Cerami so far?
Absolutely. And Wanabu came out very strong, 5 of 10. They just have to figure out how to get her way more than 10 swings because she was so effective and Prieto Cerami so ineffective.
And maybe Makaya White. Oh, nice block. Morgan Johnson, number 12, with a stuff block there for Texas as they come out and take the early lead. But just to finish the thought, Prieto Cerami and Makaya White are opposite. That means Makaya White is often available on the back row set, so you don't have to go consistently so much to Prieto Cerami while she tries to pull herself out of this.
And Collins used that a couple of times in that first game with good choices.
Good play by Lutz to take the first contact. Nice dig by Rounceville. Miscue there by Texas. Wanabu is in the backcourt. And Ivana Vanyak, number 7 in black, with a rip down the line. If you're just joining us, what a set of runs between Stanford and Texas. Back and forth we go at a timeout. Stanford trailed 18-15. They go on a 10-3 run to close out the opening set. Pretty remarkable. Here's Kelsey Humphrey, 6-foot senior out of Corona Del Mar, on to serve and play some defense. And defense it is. She was there, but not enough oxygen under that ball. Chloe Collins with her second kill.
And that's one way, Chloe Collins' choice, and since she's left-handed, that's easier for her, but her choice to attack once in a while is something that's going to help keep the Stanford block a little off balance and open things up for her hitters at the sidelines.
Makaya White with a service ace, this time against Morgan Entz.
But you could see Catherine Plummer saying, my bad, I shouldn't have backed out of that. Why? Because watch, this ball goes left to right and Plummer bailed, and that was going away from Entz and towards Plummer.
First ace so far of this championship match. One ace, one miss. One of the things that Coach Jared Elliott of the University of Texas told me early today at their practice was that Catherine Plummer hits a hugely higher percentage when she doesn't have to pass and then hit. When you make her receive, serve, and then go hit left side, she's almost hitting zero in the tournament. Oh, good block. Quick cover by Makaya White. First contact taken by the setter. And off speed, Catherine Plummer with a very, very smart shot.
You are right, Paul. What a nice adjustment. Plummer, the first swing of the match she took, she was trying to go high and hard over Chloe Collins. That time with the off speed, a much better choice.
Ajanaku leading the way with 5 kills. Plummer now 3 of 9. Prieto Cerami missed it out of bounds. Wow. And she's calling. There's a touch down the line. The first referee, Patty Rolfe, the Texas players, and there will be an overrule. You know, that's a really good overrule and good work by the officials once again, because you only have 3 challenges, and each of those is so vitally important. You got to protect those for later on.
A good call, in our opinion, and I like what the referee, Patty Rolfe, did. She just didn't look at this linesman and didn't see that the call was made on a touch. Once she noticed it later, she reversed her call.
Adriana Fitzmaurice, one of the 4 freshmen in the starting lineup for Stanford. We talked about it in the semifinal. They were the youngest team ever to make it to the national semifinal. So what does that make them here in the final, Coach?
Impressive. And even Inki Ajanaku has said it. She came in with a special group of freshmen, people like Maddie Bug, Brittany Howard, and Jordan Burgess. And she said, when we were freshmen, we couldn't have done what this group's doing.
In system, one-on-one, Ajanaku again, nice dig by White.
Oh, lucky play.
Wow, very lucky play. What a set by Jenna Gray. Right on top of the net, and Gray went up and dished it perfectly to the outside to Plummer.
That's a really good choice by a setter. When it's close to the net and you jump hard, you're almost always going to get a blocker to jump with you, which means there's one less to get to the point of attack.
4-1 run once again for Fitzmaurice and the Cardinal.
Nice up.
Prieto Cerami, misses it out of bounds. Cannot get anything to go her way. That ball deflected off of Ijoniku, and what a left-handed stab by Plummer to keep the pressure on Texas. Look at that. Plummer, an outstanding beach player and indoors as well, has represented the United States in both disciplines and won medals, and the left came out and saved that point for Stanford, now leading by two here in the second. Coverage of the NCAA championships continues with the FCS football national championship Saturday, January 7th at 12 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN2. For more information on the NCAA FCS football championship, visit NCAA.com, your home for all 90 championships. A crowd of 16,700 for the semifinals on Thursday night, and might be topping that as we welcome you back inside Nationwide Arena. Coming out of the timeout, what adjustments, Karch, does Texas have to make?
They put Prieto Sarame on the right side. They're trying to split up, and it looks like Bedard Honey finally gets to hit on the left after 2 years of playing for Texas.
Chance for Stanford once again to extend the lead, dug by McCoy. Oh, good, smart swing. Plummer had come into cover tip, so didn't run all the way back outside.
Yeah, but you have to expect, again, Prieto Sarame. I haven't seen Texas do this much all season. They're splitting it up, and they have a right-side hitter with Prieto Sarame and a left-side hitter with Yazi Bedard-Honey.
On the overpass, going to Ijoniku, two blockers up, and right over the top once again for her sixth kill on eight swings.
And the other thing I'm noticing, remember Jenna Gray two nights ago was setting Inki Ijoniku awfully low. Now she's setting her at the perfect height. It doesn't matter what block is in front of Ijoniku, she is neutralizing, just going over the top.
The run has extended to 7-1, and they're continuing to put pressure on Prieto Sarame. Ball stuffed on the outside by Jenna Gray, and the lead now is 12-7. Holly, what have you got?
Well, we talked to John Dunning about that setter and hitter combination with Inki and the sets being too low. They watched a lot of film. He thought that Jenna Gray and Inki need to make adjustments, and we've seen them adjust tonight.
Stanford with a big lead here in the second.
My grandma.
Huge for Texas to rotate so that Wanabu gets to check back in. They've been going a long time without her in the front row, and she's their, by far, their primary offensive weapon. Meanwhile, Prieto Sarame really struggling. Two kills, eight errors out of 22 swings, hitting a minus 273. She was the reverse of that and better against Nebraska the other night.
Inki Ijoniku, that ball is off the block and out of bounds. Ijoniku just ripping relentlessly. There you see the semifinal. What a lot can change in 48 hours. And let's remind everybody, this is the biggest and best block in the country. And right now, Stanford is imposing their will.
You really have to pick your spots carefully with taller blockers. And it means you can't hit just a few where the ball crosses the net by a few inches.
Wanabu snapping over the top, and to go over the top of Morel Lutz, I do mean OTT, over the top of 6'8" Lutz.
OTL, O-top Lutz. But that's a great choice by Collins and a natural one. You have to set Ebony Wanabu. She is your most efficient hitter. You got to get that ball to her whenever possible.
Really good block. There are different phases to the game. There's offense, there's defense, and Texas certainly should not forget about them being an impactful team at the net. Makaya White there with some help from Bedard Ani, and John Dunning, this year's coach of the year, is not going to take any chances. Stanford leading one set to none and 13-10 as the Cardinal have called a timeout. Bowl season continues on Monday with the Miami Beach Bowl. The Central Michigan Chippewas and the Tulsa Golden Hurricane kick off at 2:30 Eastern on ESPN. And streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Back with Holly Rowe and Karch Kirai, I'm Paul Sunderland. And so far, the Stanford Cardinal on a 10-3 run won the opening set, and now with the lead 13-10. Let's go back to Holly.
Well, you were talking about the change in fortune for Paulina Prieto-Cerame and not having the success tonight that she normally does. But I can tell you, she is working so hard to stay positive on the bench. In the huddles, in the timeout, she continues to pat her teammates on the back and say, I got you, I got you. I'm going to get better. I'll get you. Like you see right here, I know that it's not going her way tonight. She's a player of high and low emotion, but she is trying to stay up despite the frustration tonight.
And one of the things she can do is just mix her shots up a little. Even if she's high emotionally, it doesn't mean she has to come at a 10 at a max volume every swing. That's the thing that's going to take the block out of the play, is by mixing up, taking a hard swing to the deep corner, and then a roll shot, and then a cut shot, and then chipping off the end blocker.
And one of the things that's been a real hallmark for success for Texas during this tournament is being a little bit conservative offensively. Don't be afraid to just give the ball to your opponent, because they are only hitting, they meaning your opponent, only hitting 100 in terms of efficiency when they come back at you. Coming out of the timeout, Plummer, that ball left inside. Nice dig by Rouncevelt. Little confusion there. Texas not able to get a swing. Combination play, and you could hear the Texas coaches yelling out, commit, commit.
That was Eric Sullivan screaming out, commit, commit. Now, what the setter, Jenna Gray, for Stanford could do is when she hears that, she can set somewhere else, and she's going to get a hitter on no blocker. Easiest way to put the ball down.
Free ball again for Stanford. Where do they go this time? To the outside, Vanyak Dub. Chloe Collins going up into Moretta Lutz, and we're going to have a conversation about this one. She was called for blocking the set.
Let's
Chloe Collins is a backcourt player. That's a good call.
Yep.
That is a good call.
Lutz has to learn to keep her hands on her side of the net. Chloe Collins has to have a chance to play that ball. Big mistake by Lutz. She had the advantage. The dig was not in a good position. She just needed to wait and let Collins make the play.
Makaya White, who's been solid so far, over the top of the block once again. Makaya White putting up excellent numbers. The 6'1 redshirt freshman out of Frisco, Texas. Her father, Randy, the 8th overall draft pick back in 1989 of the NBA draft. So she comes from a pretty good line of quality athletes. Stanford's lead is down to 2. Where do you go here? Right side. Of course you go to Wanabu. Kat McCoy looking over to the sideline for some area instructions. Texas on a 5-1 run. Very streaky championship match so far. Collins has to make the first contact. Hittable ball on the outside. Maybe Texas missed an opportunity. Rouncevelt is digging everything on the left back. And that ball tipped over the top. And a touch is called down the line. Break for Texas here as they win a long rally and give Autumn Rouncevelt a lot of credit for that. Number 13 in white, the 5'5 freshman, digging balls for Texas.
And Lutz was telling her teammates, yep, I got that one. Great view on the replay. It hit her right hand.
Tied at 14. Rouncevelt again. Texas again. Timeout called by Stanford. Just moments ago, the Stanford Cardinal led 12-7. Wow, run after run after run.
Paul, as soon as Texas was able to get Ebony Wanabu and Micaiah White into the front row. Great things happen. They're both hitting at an astronomical level. Between them, 16 kills in 31 swings, zero errors. They got to, if they could tweak the rules of volleyball, they'd be really tough. But there are going to be these three rotations with Prieto Cerami up there, and that's where they're giving up leading points in bunches. That's why there's so much back and forth in this match.
Well, and as we saw the other night in the semifinals for Stanford when they played Minnesota, they have to deal with, because Inki Ajanaku is a middle blocker, she only plays half the time. Of course, when she rotates or her position does to the backcourt, in comes the libero. So they have to deal with that as well. And so far, Stanford, at least for the last most of this match until the last run here for Texas, has been doing a better job when Ajanaku is not available. Stanford led 13-8 on the year. Of course, wonderful resumes. Stanford was seeded number 6 overall in the tournament, 26-7, 15-5 in the very, very tough Pac-12 conference. Texas did not win the Big 12 this year. That went to the Kansas Jayhawks. Texas was the number 4 overall seed. Their record was 27-4, making it to the national semifinals for the 8th time in the last 9 years. They won their singular championship during that run in 2012. Stanford has not won the title since 2004. Texas playing some really good defense right now. Joust coming at the net and won by Vanya. Big play coming out of the Stanford timeout.
You could really see the beach background that Catherine Plummer has on that play. Scrambling, Hetz comes up with the first one, but Plummer put something up to the net so that at least her hitter could try to contend with the Texas block.
There is Morgan Hintz, the libero, missing that ball out of bounds. That is the 6th service error for Stanford and also 6 for Texas. Wannabe staying in and has been doing a pretty good job serving against John Dunning's Cardinal down the line.
But once Wannabe goes to the backcourt, now it's all on Micaiah White. Expect any transition set to go her way.
Oh, that ball out of bounds. Beautiful set that time by Plummer, but Vanyak missed it out of bounds. John Dunning questioning the second referee. Margie Ray, was there not a touch? And we might have our first challenge. Coach Dunning thinking about it. Yeah, there's the card. He's going to challenge. You can challenge ball off the block, or was that in?
I didn't see a touch on that angle.
That ball's out. And the video evidence has to be 100% conclusive to overrule the call on the floor.
Still seems as though the Stanford blockers are trying too hard to go over. Stanford blockers are trying to go to, oh, maybe there was a touch on Ebony Wannabe.
It's a touch off a player. Either off of Wannabe. This is going to be a really crucial call. Stanford led 13-8. Vanyak thought that there was a touch or the ball was in. The point on the board right now for Texas at 17-15. And officially, I've just been handed word that officially Coach Dunning is challenging, or at least this is what we've been told. Here's a tighter look. Boy, if anything, that is what we used to call a micro touch, but we're being told that the challenge is for a net touch, which would be a violation. This is a big call. Texas was in real trouble just moments ago before they were forced to call a much needed timeout. And that ball is ruled out of bounds.
Paul, I still think the Stanford hitters are trying too hard to go over the block of Chloe Collins. She's not the tallest blocker, so she's not the most effective blocker, but they're trying to go over and they keep hitting out beyond the end line.
One other point on that last video challenge.
What an up.
Texas looking to extend their lead.
Hold on.
White is rejected by Fitzmaurice.
And that's a tough set for Micaiah White to hit. Way inside, we see the Stanford machine team celebrating off their B team, working so hard to keep their A team going. They challenge them every day in practice. But that set inside for Micaiah White commits her to hit sharp angle. Good adjustment by Fitzmaurice.
Chance again for the Cardinal. Oh, bad pass. Yeah. High, flat, wonderful adjustment by Micaiah White. Just wanted to go back to that replay. The net was moving a little bit, and some of you at home, or maybe even, you know, watching once again, time and time again, might have seen Chloe Collins' long ponytail touch the net, and the net was moving a little bit. By rule, not a violation. Hair is into the net, not a violation. Here's Micaiah White. Texas, what a comeback, leading by two, but now Micaiah White with another service error, her fourth. She does have one ace, but that's not the kind of ratio that Texas wants. Holland McKenna, 5'7", sophomore out of Laguna Beach. 20 aces on the year. In-system pass, and that ball, unforced error. Morgan Johnson right into the net. That ball was set too low, wasn't it, Garch?
Too low, and I'm not sure I'd be serving Nicole Dalton.
Absolutely.
She's a very strong passer for Texas. Let's see if they go toward Prieto Sarame, a much better target. Nope, they go back to Dalton, and another perfect pass.
Out of the middle, Fitzmaurice, number 24 in black, over the top and down. Chloe Collins tipping again. Is that a sign that she's lost confidence in setting the ball to the outside?
Well, I would have lost confidence when you're too positive.
I just asked the questions, partner. I just asked the questions.
That's a smarter hit. Good adjustment by Prieto Sarame, and a rare mistake by Hintz on the dig, but Plummer saves the day.
Saw that ball coming out spinning, but the block doesn't count as a contact. And then so the first contact is by Hansen. By rule, just about anything goes. Break there for Stanford as they lead now 20-18. Oh, good rip down the line. Adriana Fitzmaurice, what a good volleyball player at 6'6". She had a match in the regional finals where she contributed 7 digs.
This is such good work by Fitzmaurice because she was blocking. She has to get off the net. That's called transition offense, and she becomes available behind the setter.
5-0 run here for Stanford. That ball set way off the net.
And another poor dig. Stanford can do better than that.
And Nicole Dalton runs past that. And Catherine Plummer with a nice choice. Texas was in trouble 10 minutes ago. Then they had gotten new life. Now they're in real trouble once again. Okay, a wide on the pipe. Hence is all over that.
Nice up.
Dig in system on target. And cut down the line. Morgan Hintz with a spectacular dig. Hintz had 30 digs against Wisconsin. She had 27 against Minnesota. 23-18 is the lead. Micaiah White. That ends a 7-0 run for the Cardinal. Really, really streaky match so far. Both of these teams running big bundles of points. Fitzmaurice off the edge of Prieto Sarame. And now set points, 5 of them for the Stanford Cardinal. They won the opening set 25-21. They closed that set on a 10-3 run, and they've done virtually the same here in the second. Serving Dalton again. And that's going to be a net violation called on Texas. The teams will head to the locker room. Your thoughts so far, Karch? Big, big advantage for Inki Ejonakwu and the Cardinal.
When Texas has Makaya White in the front row, they go on huge positive scoring runs. But when she's out in the back row and Prieto Sarame in the front, they bleed tons of points.
So Stanford takes the second set 25-19. Their fans are loving this. Two sets to none lead. Let's go over to the sideline in Holly Rowe.
Well, Coach, why are you really frustrating those big Texas pin hitters?
I think Jen is doing a really good job holding them. She's getting her feet there, making them have a little doubt of maybe what direction they need to go. And I think as we've gone, our ball control has kind of gone in and out of it. But when we have spurts, it's clearly because we're getting the ball to her a little bit better. So it's on our passers and diggers.
You know Texas will make adjustments coming out here. What is the adjustment you worry about to react to?
Well, we came in with a plan of what we guessed they were going to do. If they come do something different here, then it's on us to figure it out. I would guess they think they have to adjust, although those two sets are like that far apart. So this is just going to be a battle.
Yep.
Thank you, Holly. And the adjustment has been made. The lineup is in. Ori Agbaji, who started at the beginning of the season, the first 14 matches, the 6'2 freshman out of Kansas City, is in the lineup.
And they move Yasmin Bedard-Hani to 0-1 to the next two outside hitter, keeping Makaya White in her position. For the first time, Yazzie getting
so
to play.
So do I get a high five on that?
I'm impressed, Paul.
Not so radical. Not so radical. Well, you can't stay with the way things were going. You had to make a change.
You had to do something.
Yasmin Bedard-Hani, last year as a freshman, played opposite in this championship, has been playing in the middle since October, and now moved to the outside. What a credit to number 27. She will quickly give way. As far as the numbers are concerned, of course, all Stanford. Hit 295 to only 192 for Texas. Outblocked the Longhorns 6-4, and also were playing some superb defense. Tap over the top of the block. No, oh, late whistle. There was good teamwork by the officials. That ball was to the floor. As Karch, we take a look at the numbers that I was just alluding to. Look at that for Stanford, 71%.
71 perfect pass, which means 71% of the time their setter doesn't really have to run to make the touch. On the other hand, Texas only at about 50. That's significantly lower than they were two nights ago, where they passed at a very high percentage, handling that dangerous Nebraska serve often.
That number, as I recall, was at 63%, which is superb against Nebraska and much higher than the Texas average. Here's Kat McCoy, just underway here in the third set. Thanks for joining us once again for this championship. Texas has won it twice. Stanford looking for their seventh. And Makaya White turning wrist away and missed it out of bounds. Makaya White has been really solid once again. That's just her second hitting error on 21 swings, 9 kills. Ebony Wanabu just playing lights out throughout the course of this tournament, 10 of 18.
Wanabu's where you want to set here. Behind, she's been unstoppable.
Kept alive in the backcourt by Stanford. Go right back to her, absolutely, one-on-one. Poked up by Plummer. And some miscommunication in the backcourt. And Ivana Vanyek puts that ball right on the end line.
I'm really surprised, because Rounsfield and McCoy have been doing playing very good defense in left, back, and middle, but McCoy caught out of position.
White over the top of the block, now in double figures, joining Wanabu for Texas. Once again, the freshman of the year in the Big 12 Conference, first team All-American. She was 8 times player of the week in the conference, an all-time record. They should name the award after her. Good touch in the middle. Good block by the 6'6" Fitzmorris. Seventh stuff block for Stanford. Once again, statistically, the best blocking team in the country at over 3.3%. once given up her body to keep the ball alive. Dalton doing the same. Oh, good off-speed shot. Read by Johnson, number 12, out of the middle.
And part of it was a read, and part of it was just a low set. Now we get to see Bedard Ani on the left for the first time. Let's see if Stanford wants to test her. It's been a long time since she's been a left-side blocker. She might get a chance against Vanyak after this pass by Stanford.
What a versatile volleyball player. On the overpass, Chloe Collins, no. Break there for Stanford. And Fitzmaurice and Stanford take full advantage. Jared Elliott, you could hear on the sideline, slow down. Keep siding out.
That's one of the things the Minnesota team talked about last year. Things just felt like they went so fast.
Johnson, nice swing off the edge, one-on-one. Another very nice in-system pass for Texas.
Yeah, that would be what we'd call a perfect pass, where Chloe Collins, the setter for Texas, really didn't have to move from her spot. We'll watch now if Stanford also makes a perfect pass. That is not one. You saw Jenna Gray, the setter, having to chase it down, but Catherine Plummer saves it. And we even have a shot chart that we can show you here, where inside this circle, those are the good passes. Outside, you see a higher percentage, more dots for Texas outside that circle. That means the setter, Chloe Collins, having to sprint, like right there, sprinting way forward to save and run her offense from out of position.
There's a double contact. Good call by the first referee, Patty Rolfe. Quick note on Patty Rolfe there. You see her in the blue with her back to you. Refereed the gold medal game of the Women's Olympic Tournament in Rio de Janeiro. She was the second referee. Susana Rodriguez from Spain was the first official.
First female pair. They did a really nice job.
Here is Collins. Once again, strongest rotation for Texas with her in the back row. And that ball right on the sideline. Catherine Plummer. 11 kills now on 21 swings. Stanford is hitting over 300 now for the match.
And remember, the very first swing she took was over Chloe Collins out of bounds. So since that one, she's had only one error. Very impressive for a freshman playing a position she wasn't even really meant to play this season.
Yasmin Bedard Ani, call me an OPP, call me an MB, call me an OH1. That is a wonderful clutch performance. Wherever you want me to play, that's where I'll play to help my team.
You've got to love having players on your team who are willing to do anything. And Moretta Lutz is another one of those players. Catherine Plummer, one too.
Mikayla White. That ball was left a little bit inside. And Mikayla White absolutely roofed that ball straight to the floor.
Yeah, that would be a freshman error. When you're so out of position, probably not a good time to take a tough swing.
Good deep serve. Double quick there. Moretta Lutz coming inside as well. And the kill by Ajanaku. Stanford and Texas tied at 8 apiece.
Yeah, Lutz is coming in just to try to draw some attention away from Inge Ajanaku. But that's pretty hard to do right now.
Remember what Hugh McCutcheon told us before the match between Minnesota and the national semis? So we will give Ajanaku all the attention she deserves. And I said, so you mean every time?
And it still wasn't enough. They had hands in front of her, and she was killing the ball.
Good swing. Ivana Vanyak, who doesn't hit for a good percentage on the year, only at 167, is chipping in now. Six kills. That is a real plus for Stanford. That ball served out of bounds by Plummer again. She missed a serve to open this third set. If you're just joining us, Stanford, the number six seed, on top of Texas thanks to a 10-3 run in the opening set, 25-21, and then on a 9-1 run in the second, the Cardinal won 25-19 to take the two sets to none advantage. Good set to White. poked up, and Vanjak, in spite of her Croatian heritage and now living in Germany, could not pop that up with her foot, which would be legal, by the way, a rule change several years ago.
So far, 10 points into this third set, Paul, I got to think that's been a big move and a positive one for Coach Elliott, just because they've removed some of the negative plays, the errors that lead to direct points for Stanford.
Well, that ball, a miscue, set way too low to Moretta Lutz, and a free point for Texas, now leading 11-9. Again, the other half of the equation, number 34, not in the match right now, Ori Agbaji, the 6'2 freshman, has not played virtually at all since October. She's only played in two of the last 15 matches, but what a block again by Johnson. Now Texas starting to return the favor with five stuffed blocks. It was all Stanford in that category early. And John Dunning, trying to put an end to a 4-0 run, will call a Stanford timeout. That about says it all. Championship up for grabs. Championship. Back with U.S. Olympic team head coach and three-time NCAA champion Karch Kirai. Holly Rowe on the sideline. I'm Paul Sunderland. Nationwide Arena, Columbus, Ohio. Been a wonderful host. This building is packed. Another big play for Texas, and now with their largest lead of this third set.
And at some point, Jenna Gray has to realize, the setter for Stanford, that when three people are jumping as hard as they can for Inky, it means there are two hitters who have nobody in front of them.
Texas going to get another look. That ball left too far inside. Off speed from Wanabu.
Uh-oh.
And that's going to be a center line or net violation. A net violation called on Vanya. And you said, uh-oh. Uh-oh, that was a shankopotamus right on top of the net.
And it's not only uh-oh, she's going to net, but uh-oh, I sure hope somebody doesn't land on somebody else's ankle, as can often happen on a set like that.
6-0 run, and Stanford forced to call another and last timeout.
What's bad?
Libero Kat McCoy working on Vanya. And Moretta Lutz coming through with a clutch kill out of the timeout. Holly, what do you got?
John Dunning of Stanford in that last timeout told his young team, look, it does no good to be frustrated when things don't go right. Texas is good. There'll be frustrations. I want you staying positive to the next point. Look to the future, not to the past.
Thank you, Holly. Lutz now with her fourth kill, and Ebony Wanabu once again continuing her superb play. The first team All-American now with 12 kills on 27 swings. Dug by Rounceville. She has been absolutely key for Texas.
What an up by Fitzmaurice.
And Makaya White nicely over the top. You saw that it was 11 kills. I was thinking my iPad was a little bit late, but let's give it credit. 11 kills for Wanabu on 26 swings.
On 23 with zero errors still. She's amazing.
Thank you,
in terms of how clean a game of volleyball she's playing and how clean a tournament she's playing. Still only five errors in the whole tournament of six matches. Uh-oh.
That's just crazy numbers. Not a good set there. Stanford trailing by a lot, but that ball whiffled into the cross court, into the cross body.
You see Fitzmaurice turning and just laughing, like, and fluffing that dying quail into the corner.
Now, sometimes it can be a very frustrating game. All systems go and things don't work out, and then you'll whiffle one into the corner. Coming on to serve, Kelsey Humphreys, one of the two starting setters the beginning of the year. Makaya White once again. We haven't talked an awful lot about the really dramatic decision. Now, of course, Jared Elliott has made one in this final, but John Dunning made one against Arizona earlier this season. He went, wait a minute, this two-setter system isn't working, trailing 2-0 at home. He threw it out, drew up a new lineup on the board, and they've gone on from there.
And he drew up a new lineup, and Catherine Plummer is looking at it thinking, oh, okay, so I'm going to play outside hitter. And Kelsey Humphreys, who was the second setter, and had worked so hard to become one of Stanford's setters, waiting for years at playing behind Maddie Bug, had finally gotten her chance this year, but then lost it again. The reins handed over to Jenna Gray, and they've taken off since. That you can see that 5-1 formation, one setter formation, had tremendous success.
Bedard on the big swing, looking for a touch, and none is detected. That ball out of bounds. All of the Texas players saying there was a touch. And so Jared Elliott will go to the challenge, and he will inform the second referee, Maggie Ray, the area of the game he wants to challenge. Let's take a look.
What'd you see, Paul? I'm not sure I saw it hit the right pinky. Her teammates, every one of the Texas players was looking over at him saying, touch, touch.
And look at the change of the rotation on this ball. Yeah, I see some vibration off the inside hand of Fitzmaurice.
But as you said, it has to be conclusive. And I'm not sure they can rely on change of spin to be conclusive.
I saw some fingers move. Yeah.
Great zoom replay there.
Yeah, we've got super slow motion. The challenge system was not used in the first and second round, nor in the regionals. And this is a big call. I see a touch, Karch. Yep. I see a touch.
And I like the call, because at this point, you really want to extend this match with your new lineup.
Touch, there it is. Great use of the challenge. And nicely done by head coach Jared Elliott. But again, you get three challenges per match, not like in the Olympic Games where you have two challenges per set. And if you're proven correct, you keep it. So really have an infinite number as long as you're right all the time.
Yeah, and Texas was right on that one, but they still have one less now.
Plummer on the outside rips that ball out of bounds. You talk about your teammates supporting when you know that there is a touch. Watch the reaction from the Texas players. This was a jury of your peers, and every one of them is voting unanimously.
And as a coach, that's a good strategy. We've certainly used it with USA. When the people who know most, who hear it and see it best, are the hitter and those right underneath her in coverage, so that we rely on that a lot to decide whether we're going to challenge a touch call or not.
Fitzmaurice back to serve. Ajanaku back up front now with Plummer. And a big lead for Texas here in the third.
Interesting rotation. This is the one with the two players playing new positions. But they set probably a good choice there. Makaya White out of the backcourt instead.
Out of the pipe, right in the middle of the court. And Chloe Collins will spearhead the strongest rotation for Texas. Statistically, over the course of the year, when Collins is serving, Texas scores 50% of the time, which is a huge efficient number. Good touch by Agbaji. And Ebony Wanabu snipping right over the top.
Really nice set by McCoy after a good read on defense. You're right. Chloe Collins served a good serve, put Plummer in trouble, immediately created a scoring opportunity for Texas.
We'll get back to Stanford's receiving numbers as far as their in-system passing, but it has dropped off significantly here in the third. Good place to go. Watch Inki Ajanaku in the huddle with these four freshmen. Some of the kids, remember, told us when we spoke with them the other day, they said, look, we just do whatever Inki tells us.
Apparently, she's got some leadership abilities.
Apparently so. Here is Gray. Good block on the outside by Plummer. Bedard Ani got by with one on the touch. Very nicely done off the challenge.
Plummer sets up a nice block, but you still, if you're Texas, you have two nice options. You've got the opposite. Ebony Wanabu far across on the left. I would guess she'd set there. She does.
Track down free ball coming to Stanford. Wanabu tipping and Ajanaku rejecting. 21-16. And now it's time for Jared Elliott to try to slow down the surging Stanford Cardinal. Stanford up two sets to none, but trailing here 21-16. Remember, Stanford is out of timeouts. Jared Elliott and the Longhorns have one remaining tonight after a full slate of bowl games. Catch Sports Center at night with John Butchagrass and Nicole Briscoe. They'll have a breakdown of the bowl games, of course. The Dolphins and the Jets, as well as college hoops, the NBA, NHL, and everything else. Sports Center at night after R&L. Carrier's New Orleans Bowl between Southern Miss and Louisiana Lafayette. Big game for the Dolphins at the Jets. Talked about Makaya White. Now 14 kills on 30 swings, hitting 400 efficiency, 7 digs and 6 blocks.
And even a service ace. That she, one of the things she really helps in Texas's system is that they can set her and get lots of good back row swings. They weren't able to do that enough in sets 1 and 2. When they needed it most, they need it less now that they've gotten some more productive offensive options out there, bringing Bedard Hani in and bringing Agbaji in.
Texas is siding out at 75% in this third set. Stanford has dropped to 57. Let's quickly go to Holly.
Makaya's White has been incredible this year, the National Freshman of the Year, but she did not get off to an auspicious start this season. In her first match, she told us, "I was terrible, hit negative 147. She said, "You know, I had to realize I'm good enough and talk to myself about being a confident player." She says, "I've gotten better every single match this year." She's very proud of herself after that very tough start.
And she, like the rest of her teammates, are going to have to be tough here. And remember, we had some wonderful sound from the sophomore Yasmin Bedard Hani in the Texas locker room. Now or never. And I love what she said. We can all do something better. No pointing fingers. Everybody can contribute more. And she does there with a nice off-speed shot. 22-16. Good deep serve. What a good set by Chloe Collins.
And Ebony Wanabu is so consistent. She can go over the block regularly, but she mixes it up where she puts it over the block. That in the high corner.
Plummer going down the line, registering another kill. She, like the rest of her Stanford teammates, and give Texas a lot of credit, has been a little bit slowed down here, now with 12 kills on 25 swings. Chloe Collins has not set a Baji yet. Should the Stanford block completely ignore her so far?
That would be my choice, although there she would have to set her, because going up with one hand, the right hand, that's about the only place she can put it. If the pass is a little off the net or more, I would expect it to go to one sideline in front or the other behind.
Chloe Collins in the backcourt, ball penetrated the plane, so she cannot go up and participate in the block. Good call. Wanabu again, smart shot off of Vanya. Wanabu now with 14 kills on 28 swings, hitting 464, Bedard Hani 444. Texas set points now.
Only 6 hitting errors in 6 matches in the NCAA tournament.
And the block there, good cover. Set point swing. Ebony Wanabu again. OTT over the top of the tallest, best block in the country. And a wonderful response, Karch Kirai from the Texas Longhorns, taking that third set 25-18 in a must-win situation. The Longhorns are on the board, and the battle is rejoined for the 36th NCAA title. When you're lost in the tunnel, and you're
Ramsey's speech in the locker room and the fact that Coach Jared Elliott made a bold move and switched two players into different positions, or actually took Prieto Sarame out. They also defended Inki Ajoniku a lot better that game, where she only had a net one kill off nine swings.
Texas hits 344 in the third. They hold Inki Ajoniku and Stanford to 189 and won that third set quite easily, 25-18. Ajoniku will start on the sideline.
And one thing I see, Stanford has changed the matchups. Paul, when you put a lineup out on the floor, you can have any one of your six players be the first server. They've what we call it spinning the dial. They've rotated to get a different matchup. Interesting to try to get some better blocking matchups and offensive matchups at the net.
Underway here in the fourth. Thanks again so much for joining us here in Columbus, Ohio, Nationwide Arena. Chloe Collins missing that ball just out of bounds. Here is Fitzmaurice back to serve. Good dig by Holland McKenna, covering behind the block against Wannabe. And again, missed that ball out of bounds. Just underway again here in the fourth. Back to Holly Rowe.
In that last Stanford huddle, their leader, Inki Ajoniku, told them, "We are hesitating too much. Everybody's second-guessing themselves. Where is our confidence and our belief in ourselves? I want to see players going after the ball. Stop thinking. Stop second-guessing yourself and just play."
Bummer off the left side looking for hands. And a touch was called by the linesman right behind number two in black, Catherine Plummer, who puts up yet another kill. The National Freshman of the Year, the Pac-12 Freshman of the Year. No question about that. There you see it in super slow motion off the right hand of number 34, Oria Baji.
The first set to Agbaji.
And a quick start here for Inki Ajoniku and the Stanford Cardinal. If you're Jared Elliott, it's 4-0. Can you wait any longer? Absolutely not. Not one play more. And a quick early timeout called by Texas.
And you can see him shaking his head to Chloe Collins. Why are you setting her for the first time now? We got great pin hitters. Let's get them the swings.
So an early timeout. Remember, two timeouts per set per team. Coverage of the NCAA championships continues with the FCS Football National Championship Saturday, January 7th at 12 p.m. Eastern on ESPN2. For more information on the NCAA FCS Football Championship, visit NCAA.com, your home for all 90 NCAA championships. Just heard from Holly Rowe on the sideline, back with three-time Olympic champion and our U.S. Olympic team head coach Karch Kirai. I'm Paul Sunderland. There is a very, very distinguished list, no question about that. Penn State at one point won four in a row from 2007 to 2010, then won again in 2013 and 2014. And the Stanford Cardinal looking to get into rarefied air, Karch Kirai, and tie the Nittany Lions, who were narrowly eliminated earlier in this tournament at Nebraska. They had a chance to pull off a huge upset. So we've seen the Texas adjustment with their lineup. What have you seen from Stanford coming back from losing that third set 25-18?
The first thing I saw was Stanford spinning the dial a little, clicking it a couple of places to get some different matchups. And so far it's given Texas problems. This is probably not as good a rotation because Bedard Hani is on the right. They like her more if she's going to play a left side hitter to be on the left. And Ebony Wannabe to start this set with the rare hitting error, hitting over the block but out of bounds.
Chance again for Stanford to extend. They lead, and they do. Off-speed shot once again from the freshman Plummer.
And really well executed, Paul. When you get set up to hit and you get your elbow way back, like Plummer did on that one, very difficult to read. Ball has a good, much better chance of falling down to the floor behind the block.
Stanford in complete control and dominating Texas right now from the service line. And defensively and blocking, off-speed shot. And tipped over. Aren't they indeed? Jenna Gray, the Stanford Cardinal, just clicking on all cylinders right now. And Jared Elliott's going to have to burn his second and final timeout. Look at that read by Jenna Gray out of Shawnee, Kansas, the national co-high school player of the year last season. And once again, if you haven't been following the Stanford Cardinal, getting lots of support from the bullpen, but the youngest team ever to advance to a national semifinal. And even I can figure out that that makes them the youngest team ever to play for this championship.
And now 19 points away from Stanford's first title since 2004, when Aguna Namani led them to that title in Southern California.
Quickly with this timeout, let's go back to Holly.
Well, we just saw that great play made by Jenna Gray, the freshman setter for Stanford. She's got a lot of other talents and skills that are helping her play volleyball better. She has become a fantastic javelin thrower, a state champion with the javelin. In fact, she was struggling a little bit last year throwing the javelin, and her coach for track and field said, let's take you back out on the volleyball court, because there's something about the wrist snap with how she attacks the ball in volleyball and javelin. She's hoping to possibly compete for the Stanford track and field championship or team this later this spring. She said, we are definitely talking about that, but her confidence from the track helps her have confidence on the court.
Thank you, Holly. I don't know if the javelin and darts have anything in common, but she is throwing bullseyes right now.
And if you look at Texas, Paul, on the screen, all three of their front row hitters are now pulled over to the left side of the court. They're trying to give a different alignment. Maybe Medard Hani hitting a slow play in the middle. That's what they go with.
Texas has got to get out of this rotation. And finally they do, and it took a big effort. Boy, Ebony Wanabu barely got that ball out of her hand before Inki Ajanaku was all over it. So Texas finally on the board here in the fourth. Long way to go, and it's been a very, very streaky match. Texas has had a number of big scoring runs.
But Texas is very happy to get into their good scoring rotations. They have Makaya White at the net and Ebony Wanabu at the net. And now they get themselves a chance in transition.
Wanabu every time, and Autumn Rounceville, number 13 in white, you pointed it out during the intermission, putting up huge numbers. That's her 16th dig so far, and she only plays part-time.
She's only on the court about half what a libero is, because she only gets to play through the back row. She is now playing for Yazi Bedard Hani in the back court. Yazi will come back up to the back in at left front. But so she's only on the court half the game. That's really productive as a defender.
You heard that whistle. A ball had rolled onto the court, so we will replay the point. Of course, you're going to Wanabu. Good set to the outside. White over the top, and almost overrunning it was Kelsey Plummer. So a pretty nice response here, 3-0 run. But remember, Texas is out of timeouts. Right side, Janaku. Her numbers again, 13 kills on 26 swings.
That is so impressive. You have a really strong left side blocker, and Makaya White has been slowing down slide hitters all season. And Inki just goes over her like she's not even up.
Talked about Ajanaku's ACL injury. She missed all of last year. Rounceville again with wonderful ball control. Back to Plummer. Hence is there, did not violate the center line. Dug again, this time by McCoy. Oh, what a dig, still alive. point, Stanford. What an effort by both of these teams. Plummer again, putting a little extra effort. You could really see the freshman number two in black gathering herself to attack that ball.
And she's the beneficiary of having Inky Ajoniku attracting a lot of attention in the middle. So she had a very late arriving middle blocker to take to get the kill to the floor.
3-0 run out of the timeout for Texas. 3-0 run for Stanford to respond until that ball was served out of bounds.
And that's been happening back and forth this whole match. The first set alone, two huge runs for each team before Stanford closed it out.
10-3 run for Stanford in the opening set, and then a 9-1 run to put an end to it to take the two sets to none lead. Really good set. Smart wrist away swing by Plummer.
And Jenna Gray had the presence of mind to set that straight up and then back out of the way, giving Plummer time. See how Gray is actually standing off the court. She made a nice move to give Plummer the room to take that swing.
Micaiah White going for a little bit too much, the unforced error.
And it's interesting because you've talked about it. We've seen her tip a lot when it's not there. That time trying to make something out of nothing, not a good choice in that situation. Puts them down 7 now, 11-4.
5-1 run for Stanford. Rounceville. Good pokey to keep that ball alive. Ajoniku once again with a period. Boy, the work she's got to do. The middle blockers on both sides. Attack, move right, left, attack, back and forth and back and forth, and then putting the ball away.
You can see she's ready for some oxygen right now. She is jumping as hard as she can, trying to stop Wanabu and White.
Ball's got to come. Oh, out of the middle. Huge gutsy choice there. And Morgan Johnson, who's been in the middle all season long, a little more comfortable target than Agbaji. Stanford leads 2-1, 12-5 for the championship. Oh, good change of pace down the line. Micaiah White registering another kill, now with 16.
Much better choice on that than the time she cut it and went so sharp it went into the net.
Texas still only hitting 213 for the match. They've been hitting 356 in the tournament coming in. Working on Vanya, who misses it out of bounds. John Dunning right behind. He's talking to his team, thinking about challenging for a touch there. And there will be no challenge. It's 12-7. Texas and Stanford have two challenges remaining. Quick set out of the middle after a perfect pass from the libero Morgan Hintz. Ends a 3-0 run. What a streaky match once again.
And Jenna Gray switched up the offensive pattern. I think that's where Lutz is probably most effective on that shoot set in front of the setter.
Oh, what a dig. Holding your ground. What else have you got? And then slap right to the floor. Morgan Johnson again for the 8th stuff block for Texas. 10 so far for Stanford.
This is where Texas has struggled a little more. No Micaiah White in the front row. No Ebony Wanabu in the front row.
Micaiah White, can she dial up another ace? That ball way into the court gave it a pretty good rip. Right side again to Lutz. First pass dug by Dalton nicely, and then once again coming through number 17 in black as she will head to the sideline, giving way to Humphrey, the defensive specialist. Pretty good routine over in the bullpen. They had some good examples in Rio de Janeiro.
And Lutz just putting her 6 foot 8 inch frame to use. She can hit some very sharp angles from that height.
White out of the back row, demanding a challenge for a touch there. And there again, two remaining. The points on the board right now, and Jared Elliott talking to the second referee, and he's going to challenge. Like the previous play in the earlier set, in set number three. Boy, that was close. But the Texas players were absolutely convinced on a swing from Bedard on knee that there had been a touch.
Here's another look, Paul. Well, so far those two do not look conclusive to me. You have to have conclusive evidence. Ooh, ooh, man. Great looks we're getting. Great looks on these replays, but
it's a huge call. Watch for the fingers to move.
Well,
I think I see a micro touch there, Cartoon.
On the left hand.
Yes, on the left hand of Fitzmaurice.
God, what a view of that. This is not the HD super slow mo that we got to work with at the Olympics, but her crew,
this is awfully good.
Fantastic job in finding these replays, finding the best angles. And you're right, Paul, this is a huge call. You just don't want to let this spin out of control at this point if you're Texas.
Well, it's a 2-point switch. If the challenge is upheld, then it's 14 to 9, excuse me. And they're taking their time. And it has to be, again, 100% conclusive to overturn the call on the court. First referee, Patty Rolfe. Second referee, Margie Ray. Second referee is responsible for the video replay.
It was interesting, Coach Dunning talking on media day a few days ago, just how he feels like the game's gone too fast. They are not calling a touch. That the game's gotten so powerful, so fast, the challenge is the way to go. It's impossible as a referee to make all those calls correctly.
Ebony Wanabu getting some attention as she's out of the match right now, stretching it out. What a job she has done over the course of this tournament. So the point stays on the board, and Stanford now with a commanding 15-7 lead. Dug by Morgan Hintz again. A net violation, but what a play defensively as Morgan Johnson will go back to serve.
And now the Stanford players are talking to Coach Dunning, telling him they didn't net. In our experience at the USA level, very often the players are right about the touches, almost always, and wrong about the net calls. Don't believe them when they say they didn't net. They don't often feel it.
Tough chance for Bedard on knee. Smart shot. Texas has got to have every point here, and ripped onto the sideline, and that ball once again by number 27, Yasmin Bedard Ani. Started the match in the middle. If you're just joining us, coming out of the intermission, Texas was in real trouble, and Bedard Ani moved from the middle to the outside.
And earlier this week, Coach Elliott was talking about, she is unflappable. We have total trust in her in any situation in this tournament.
Going to get another opportunity, a tough one. That ball drifted off the net. Good choice to White. Hintz is all over that. Long rally. Players are exhausted, and finally 6'6", Adriana Fitzmaurice able to put the ball away. Remember, Texas is out of timeouts. They have one challenge remaining. Stanford has two, and now a 16-10 lead. Solid night once again for Fitzmaurice. Through the block and down once again for Bedard on eight. Before that swing, Stanford was hitting 367 here in the fourth. Texas minus 135, meaning they had more errors than kills. Wanabu back in the left front. Strongest rotation for Texas. If they're going to make a move back into this, they need to do it now. And can't. Fitzmaurice again high up into the seam and down. Ijanaku, speaking of rotations and matchups, Ijanaku back up front now for Stanford.
And for Texas, Micaiah White due to rotate up as soon as they win the next rally.
Bedard on the wrist away off the block. Wow, what a performance. Look at Jared Elliott. He's just smiling right now. What a job this young woman has done for her team.
She's played three positions in two national semifinals or finals in these last two seasons.
That's going to be a net violation. Good block that time called on number 34, Oriya Baji,
who, as you mentioned before, just hasn't been on the court much, so you might expect more. You see her touching the net with her left forearm there. You'd expect less consistency just when you need it most.
But she stepped into a huge moment. Speaking of the freshman for Stanford, only a freshman in her own right, and she's done just fine. Oh, Wanabu is blocked. You've got Lutz at 6'8", Ijanaku at 6'3" in the best jumper, and then Plummer, number two in black, at 6'6".
So you have the best offensive lineup for Texas against the best defensive lineup for Stanford. Best blockers, best defenders.
Service error there from Jenna Gray. Big break here for Texas.
Yeah, if you're Stanford and you have that great blocking matchup, you don't want to miss. You want to try to make Texas earn their way out, earn its way out. Texas, though, still hoping to run points because they have White and Wanabu at the net.
And Ijanaku, a rare miss out of the middle. So a missed serve, ball hit long. Texas needs more of this if they have any hope of getting back in. Trailing 2-1 and 19-14 in the fourth.
Look for those Texas blockers, just like what they did on the last play, to key on Ijanaku with a good pass, but that looked like it might have hit the floor.
That ball was down. Yeah, good call by the second referee. You know, let's remember, there are 16,500 people in here. It was a bang-bang play, and all that matters is you get it right. So good work by the officials, and that ball was definitely on the floor.
I think this pair has been calling a really good game. Even if they're taking a little longer to get the call, they're getting the right call.
Timeout called by Stanford. Texas back within four on a 3-0 run. Kat McCoy with the ace. Here's a look back. Yep, no question. That ball off of the Stanford receiver and straight into the floor. Looks fairly obvious in super.
As a 13 or 14-year-old, he knew he wanted a coach her. She was that dynamic. And he just had to stay on that court for several matches watching her play. There's those, the Inkettes, the impact freshmen, who have held up so well especially since Stanford made that lineup change in the middle of October against Arizona.
Well, you talk about any team. I mean, look at how Texas is handling hugely dramatic lineup changes. Fine, let's just go play. And Stanford did the same thing.
And that's why these two teams are in this position. They've been the ones who have adapted the most.
Right side, Plummer. Rounceville all over that. Big swing here off the top of the block. Back to Plummer. Teams battling on right side attacks and another net violation. Hard work at the net by Texas, but they trail 20-15 as Plummer goes back to serve.
Plummer's got a dangerous serve, but she's been higher error today.
Tough serve down the line. Look at Hintz, not only digging, but right on target. A net violation. Late whistle, but a net violation and no complaint whatsoever. And a rip out of the middle from Morgan Johnson. That makes it 20 to 16. And Wannabe goes back to the service line. Moretta Lutz on the quick. And let's remember all the lineup changes that we've seen. She was a middle attacker last year, so quite comfortable.
For the last 2 years, and then just last spring, started working on playing the right side, the opposite position, and she's been shutting down left side hitters all season. She has an opportunity here.
Stanford now just 3 points away as they register their 12th stuff block. The Stanford Cardinal have won this championship 6 times, but the last in 2004. Texas has got to be perfect right now. Makaya White, what more could you ask? 17 kills on 44 swings. But Texas has been held down by the defensive hints and the block of Stanford Karch. Only 209 is a hitting efficiency. There is the prize, and it awaits. Mirta Bastilovic, number 17. Lightly used 6'3" junior out of Croatia, coming on to add some size blocking.
Came up with some huge blocks in the regional final last year against Florida to keep them alive, help them come back.
Remember how Texas trailed BYU in the regional semifinals. And that ball missed out of bounds, just like against BYU, trailing 11-5 in the fifth. Now it will take a miracle for Texas to get back into this. Kelsey Humphreys back to serve. 23-17. Free ball on the slide, and that ball hit out of bounds. Wow. That was an opportunity there. That could have been all. Look at John Dunning. He's been through it all. 16th year at Stanford, 32nd year overall. Veselovic back on, and no setter on the floor now for Texas if they dig a ball. John Dunning won 2 championships at Pacific. He's won 2 at Stanford. Nicole Dalton. Good swing again. Nicole Dalton, number 7, the 5th-year senior, has had her playing time limited because of 3 hip surgeries, but she was recruited as a setter and looked very comfortable there.
Yeah, any ball that comes up that she doesn't touch first, Nicole Dalton's going to have to run the offense for Texas.
Perfect pass, right side once again. Vanya coming through with a big swing. And now, match points, NCAA championship points for Stanford. Convert for Texas, and Bedard Ami does. What a performance. 1 championship point saved. Texas in their strongest rotation. Plummer missed it out of bounds. If you're John Dunning, remember you have challenges remaining. And we're going to have a timeout. So two, one match point saved, one by the board for Stanford at 24-21. Who else but Inki Ejanakou running the Stanford huddle?
Coach Dunning said it is her huddle. They're all looking at her anyway. She might as well be doing the talking.
John Dunning asking his player, what do you want to run in this situation? Both teams out of timeouts. Stanford has two challenges remaining, Texas one. Championship point number three. Where do you go, Karch?
I think you go back to Plummer. Or Jenna Gray has gotten a few down. Ebony Wanabu was warning her team about this shot on two.
Got to serve in, got to serve tough. Little confusion there in the backcourt. Plummer off the edge and Stanford wins it. The Penn State Nittany Lions with their seventh title and the fifth for John Dunning, joining some very rarefied air. A pretty inauspicious championship point. It looked like Stanford was in trouble, but Catherine Plummer, the National Freshman of the Year, took a rip from about 14 feet off the net.
Been 12 long years
long,
at Stanford.
Long.
They had some great teams, but ran into an absolute machine in Penn State, winning four in a row in 2007 to 2010.
Well, Inki, you had an injury that kept you on this team another year. What does it mean to you to be the leader out here, to lead this young squad to a national championship?
I mean, this is an incredible group of people, on the court and off the court. We grew so much this year. I grew, they taught me so much. And just to be able to get this win, I knew we could do it from the beginning of the season. And now that everyone finally believes it in themselves, it's something remarkable.
Tonight was hard at times. There were so many times Texas had three blockers up in your face, and you would rise up and find success. How did you do that?
Thanks to my setter. Cass just told me to keep snapping high. I know the straight down kills aren't as satisfying, are more satisfying, but I had to keep snapping the pointers. And just keeping that mindset to play smart volleyball instead of just brute volleyball. We all played that way, and it's incredible.
The last Stanford National Championship in volleyball was 2004. Most of your teammates were 6 years old. What does it mean to bring this home to the Cardinal family?
We are just so happy. Stanford's such a great program. And we have so many great people come through the program, and they didn't have this moment. And for us to have that moment, it's so humbling. Thank you.
Thank you.
Take a look back at NCAA championship point. And Stanford was in some trouble. Look at this swing. Off the edge of the block, Catherine Plummer finished with 18 kills, Ajanaku 16. And it was their block and defense holding the juggernaut of the Texas offense that had been hitting at 356. There it is, to only 217. And congratulations to the Stanford Cardinal and John.